Good evening. It is a great pleasure to have you here as a guest, Mestre Nestor Capoeira. Nestor is a capoeirista from the mid-60s in Brazil, one of the pioneers of teaching in Europe and London. He has several books, and some of those has been translated to the English, Dutch, German, and welcome, Nestor.
It's a great pleasure to be here again after a couple of months, to be in your academy with you, Mestre Han, Mestre Suellen, and meet these nice young ladies and young gentlemen which belong to your group. It really is a pleasure to be here.
I have a question for you. To me, it's very important. Huh? Why capoeira? Why Nestor Capoeira?
Well, there are two versions of this story. I'm going to tell you the true one. Is you know that in around 78 there was a movie about capoeira called Cordão de Ouro, Gold Necklace, né? And the guys called me to play the main actor there. And they said, you have to have a artistic name. I never had a nickname in capoeira. It was always Nestor, which is my actual name, Nestor. Né? And I thought, oh man, I think I'm going to call myself Nestor Capoeira.
Well, I think that fits very well because your life has been a life of a true capoeirista. Old-fashioned capoeirista at the time, it resembles a little bit your first teacher, Mestre Leopoldina. There is some resemblance between your way of being and his.
I think you knew, you were talking that you knew Leopoldina.
Yeah. I first met him in 1983. Mestre Acordeon took a group of students, his first group, to Brazil, and I was with that group, and we met him in Rio, and he left quite an impression on us. And then the last couple years, he's passed through here, and so I've seen him over the years, and he always is a very striking character, a very unique personality in capoeira. And then we were talking about him, and you, the last time you were here, you told the story of when you first met him, how you first saw him, and I think it's a wonderful description of him, and I'd like to know if you could share that.
Yeah. I didn't start capoeira as a boy, which I think is very good because your body grows with the practice. Né? I started when I was already 18 years old, something like that. Anyway, I was at a certain place and come this guy riding a bicycle. This is 1965. And he has on these striped pants, these shoes with very thick soles that were in fashion at that time. I don't remember how they were called.
Well, we used to call that the platform shoes.
That's it, the platform.
I remember that. Yeah. That's when I was a teenager, and all those things, like, oh, cool.
Yeah. And his platform shoes on the sides, it had little silver stars as well that he put in there. So there comes this guy with his striped pants, this shoes with thick soles, just a vest, no shirt, a little hat like those that Frank Sinatra used to wear, with a little rim and a little feather or something like that. And with the stick, I thought it was a stick at that time, and his mouth and poof, poof, from the bicycle. I look at this guy. I said, man, who is this black guy, man? The face very marked like that, very special features. And the guy comes with the bicycle, and he stops. He gets off the bicycle. And then I see that the stick goes around his neck. And yeah, I realized that that stick that was, I thought was stick painted black, red, and white was actually a snake. And he, in fact, I found out later, he raised non-venomous snakes in his garden. And that was one of his favorites. He traveled around with it in his mouth so it wouldn't fall up because he was going so fast. And when he got off, the snake relaxed and curled around his neck. And that was my first meeting of him. I found out that he was a capoeira teacher. Capoeira in 65, there were four or five places where you could practice capoeira in Rio, in the outskirts of Rio. I didn't know that they existed. I thought capoeira was something that happened in the 1920s, 1930s, and was just a myth. The capoeira, the malandro. And I was surprised that guy was giving capoeira class. I went there, and he was so friendly, so... And I inscribed myself. I thought it would be a hobby in my life. And with time, I got involved, and I got to this situation where I am now, which was marvelous for me.
As you say, that Mestre Acordeon taught you capoeira, taught you movements. But we know we have had Mestre Acordeon here. He has given some lectures, so to speak, that he talks. He talks a lot about his time and about the malandragem, the Rio de Janeiro, the hills, the morros, and all that. I want to know how much that has been passed down to you in terms of teaching, you know, not only movements, capoeira, but also the malandragem, the philosophy behind malandragem that I know you well describe in your book and make some kind of comments and comparison to other the Hindu knowledge and the comparison with the malandragem. I want to know how much of Mestre Acordeon has influenced your life in that matter.
Yeah. Well, he opened a new door for me because besides teaching me the strict capoeira thing, the berimbau, the playing, the kicks and all that, he had a small group. We were six or eight. At those times, a guy that had, like I said, there were five or six capoeira groups in Rio on the outskirts. If one of them had 12 pupils or 15 pupils, it was very big at that time. And besides teaching us, he would just take us out to the samba schools, to the Afro-Brazilian cults, candomblé, macumba, to the bars that he knew. And when he was young, he was in the reformatory when he was a teenager for a couple of years. And then later on, he went out and he met this guy called Quinzinho, who was a bit of a bandit, had a gang. And Quinzinho was a great capoeira guy. So he finally became a pupil of Quinzinho, but also went into Quinzinho's gang. And then later on, Quinzinho was killed in prison, very young, 22, 23 years old. And Leopoldina disappeared from the scene because then Quinzinho had a lot of enemies, you know. He didn't have the backup of that tough guy. And a couple of years later, he met Arthur Emidio, which is one of the most important guys in the history of capoeira of Rio de Janeiro. He came from Itabuna in Bahia in the 50s to do free fighting matches, like we see today in Japan, Papa, in Rio they did that. And he came, but besides that, he was a wonderful capoeirista, and he was Leopoldina's second master. So, but to answer your question, Leopoldina opened to me all these doors to, let's say, not only the Afro-Brazilian culture, which I, as a middle-class son, my father was a military, his father was military, I was apart from that. Not only that, but I realized that this man had another insight towards life, toward people. He had the joy of living, and he was a gentleman, and he was funny, and he enjoyed women, he enjoyed his friends, and you never would say that that guy had been living in the Wonderworld. And we went there, all the bandits, the hustlers, the guys who were robbing banks, the police, oh, La Puccina, nice guy, blah, 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 blah. So for me, it was like living inside the film, you know? And at first, it was just fascinating, but then I started to imitate him in certain things, just like you imitate your teacher doing some movements, né? In certain of his mental things, try to learn a little bit of that. And this was very important for me. He opened many doors for me, yes.
Are somewhat pioneers of capoeira in other countries. Mestre Acordeon here in the United States, and I believe you have been in London, and you were one of the first people to go there and teach capoeira. And I'm wondering what you think of how capoeira in other countries has taken on a certain look or appearance or a style that might have affected the way capoeira is now in Brazil. And also how all of this affects the current history of capoeira in the making.
I think the influence of capoeira being practiced in the United States and in Europe, although this has been going on since 1971 in Europe, and here in the States, I believe, since 1975, has not yet been fully acknowledged it has not exerted its strength in the capoeira in Brazil. But this is going to happen very quickly, I believe, in the next five years. What I see now is like seeing a film that I have seen before, but with different actors and different clothes. Because when I started capoeira in the 60s, Salvador was the mainland of capoeira. Rio had six capoeira academies, and São Paulo had even less. Now they say that Rio has 1,200, the city of Rio, right? For you to see the expansion. And at that time, the capoeiristas of Bahia, they were very worried with this growing of capoeira in Rio de Janeiro and São Paulo, and including with the exodus of some of their top capoeira guys, like was the case of Mestre Acordeon that went to São Paulo in the 70s.
68.
Now, 68. So they were worried with that. And what is happening now is that the same way that from Salvador it expanded to Rio, São Paulo, and to the rest of Brazil, up to a point that now we may say that the centers of capoeira are really Bahia, Rio, São Paulo, with other states with a lot of strong influence. I think what is happening now is something similar. From Brazil, we're going to have the influence of the United States and the influence of Europe. I don't think this is going to change so much the heart, the movements and all that, but the context, the thing that is around the heart, the relationships between teacher and pupils, between teachers of different groups, the power games, everything is going to change quite a lot once more, because capoeira is always changing due to this influence of capoeira being taught in Europe and the United States and other places, and the consequences that these things bring. But what do you think?
Well, I believe very much that capoeira is already changing because it's another country. In many ways, I can see that. So I have witnessed a transition of the capoeira from late 50s to now, very big. And I see the influence of the capoeira going outside of Brazil. And if I do not embrace that totally as something desirable, it is something inevitable. And in the United States, capoeira does not have the same significance for the students. In majority, the people see some things and go searching capoeira different aspects. And if they do not find in capoeira the response to that quest, then they will not stay with capoeira. So capoeira adapts in that direction. But you know about this whole historical trajectory of capoeira has been like that. Changes.
True.
And you are one of those who has been digging into parallels and historical aspects of the capoeira and influences of that too.
How do you characterize capoeira in Rio and São Paulo, say pre-1968, before the arrival or the influx of masters from Bahia?
Well, there had been capoeira guys coming to São Paulo and to Rio since the 1950s. But if you talk with the guys who were in São Paulo, like Bira, like Mestre Acordeon, was there in the heroic period when they were building the thing, or the guys in Rio, although some people were coming there, it was something very... There were four schools... you could not earn a living with capoeira. It was something that was done because people loved it and they practiced it in their original land where they come from, Bahia, papapá. It gave them that strength and everything. But I don't think any of those guys could ever imagine that in 10 years' time or 15 years' time, you could be a professional living out of capoeira. So it was quite a different period in the beginning. Eh?
And when I moved to São Paulo in 1968, really, capoeira was incipient. Was not. Because the big boom of the contemporary capoeira happened after 1969 encounters for attempts to organize capoeira, 71, the regulation of the capoeira of sport. And all those things happening because Bahia, that's my city, beloved city, and we Baianos, we are the owner of the truth. We know everything. You know,
qual é meu pai?
You have nothing to teach me. So the capoeira of Bahia during many years recently was perhaps one of the worst capoeira of Brazil, in spite of the axé and the mask remaining in Bahia. However, when we moved to São Paulo, even in Rio de Janeiro in 63, 64, when the capoeira of the Rio begins to pick it up a little bit more, because the people in those states are not so much into the traditions, into the culture in which capoeira thrives, was easy for them to train more capoeira, a little bit freer from preconceived ideas and a whole bunch of rules or standards of capoeira that limited the growth in other areas. I believe that. That was the big boom of capoeira happened more recently. But as you look at that, we are repeating history in terms of capoeira. No. Somehow. No. Yeah. But I'm still very interesting. How come you find that capoeira had no ginga in the past? No. This was a novelty for me.
No. For me, it's not exactly that. And what I say is that in the 1830s, according to Rugendas and Debray's drawings and their description, is that we had a capoeira that the guys were jumping around and they used mostly head hits. So we didn't have many elements of capoeira as the established ginga of today. We didn't have the movements on the ground. The acrobatics didn't exist. The swipes are not present in their description. The berimbau is not there. Nonetheless, you find African dances that existed in Brazil, which were with acrobatic jumps, not with the interaction of capoeira, but people doing things like this, like they did in Africa. You find the berimbau in Brazil, but as a solo instrument. People tell their memories, the tales of the country. In Cuba, it's used in ceremonies where they talk with their ancestors. Né? But in Brazil, it's not linked to capoeira. You have fighting techniques who use the feet, which is not in Rugenda's description of capoeira. All of this separated. So what I say is that these things came together in Brazil after 1834, probably according to the evidence that we have now. But a lot of research is being done, material is coming up, and maybe this theory would not be valid in 3 years, 5 years, 10 years.
Yeah, the history of the capoeira is unquestionably very convoluted and hidden, and is a subject of many speculations. And everybody takes a take in that. What I agree entirely with Nestor, that you can trace it back from 1800 up to now. It's very obvious. Whatever you have before is just deductions and different ideas.
one of the things that I wanted to ask, Master, is, as you know, you have been a student of capoeira, and now you're teaching, passing on your learnings of capoeira. What are some of the things, you know, that as technology also advances and things of such, what are some things that are missing now that are key and essential to maintain that, you know, even now as capoeira is being taught outside of Brazil, what are those things, and what is your opinion of how we should, what we should do to keep those, so that capoeira continues to be, you know, that art form that originated in Brazil that you learned?
There is a guy very famous in Portuguese language, a poet called Fernando Pessoa, and he has something that says, tudo vale a pena se a alma não é pequena. I mean, everything is worthwhile if the soul is not small. I think this is, for me, this is a key thing, you know? I think I don't think I am capable of saying what is missing, what is not missing. I find this a wonderful moment in capoeira. Wonderful. Everything is worthwhile if the soul is not small. So I think the thing that we should try to exercise, besides training, of course, which is basic, is to enlarge our soul, or whatever you want to call it, né? The fantasy, the imagination, the relationship with things of life which are not so obvious, whatever.
That's wonderful. It's more than capoeira itself. It's almost like a some guidance for life, if you want to live in the full extent of your possibilities and really enjoy what you do. In the practical sense, there is the need for the teacher to lay down some key elements, that these are the guides for the North American or the European students to conduct themselves, knowing that this guidance, you know, this guideline, these elements are not the creation of the teachers, but something that does belong to the art form. For example, you should talk about some traditional way of doing capoeira, you talk about the rhythms of the capoeira in the berimbau, the malandrage, the negas, the philosophy that capoeira have, and try to point out to the student what are the changes in capoeira that are within the capoeira approach, and what are the changes that you get out of the capoeira track. And then I told this recently to my students, and I know that I'm unique in that, like an old-fashioned guy, Mestre Biba said, too much flexibility is not good for capoeira. That's true, you lose your power. And I tell the students, you do have a wonderful tool of physical development among the other sex. And then I get to class, and then the students want to do push-ups, sit-ups, stretches, abdominals. Not saying that those things are not good for the body, but as more as you go in that trip, we begin to assimilate Western ways of doing things within an art form that is so much to keep, to preserve those key elements. And I think about the ginga, the listening to the music, you know, the way of deal in the confrontation of the problems. You know? Capoeira is very different from karate. You are not confronted the enemy directly. You need to get all that mind, the philosophy, what you talk. Once, we remember in Germany, we had this talking about, and you did that illustration about the chamadas.
Yeah.
That wonderful example in life. Some of the strategy, the key points that we perhaps needed to tell them. Because if you do not spell it out, they will not get. Yeah. chamadas?
About the chamadas? Well, the chamadas is a part in capoeira. Capoeira already is something that has a ritual, right? It doesn't have such rigid established rules as a sport, football, baseball, basketball, soccer. But it has a certain ritual, a certain ambience that directs what is happening. And in certain styles of capoeira and in certain rhythms of the berimbau, there is this thing called the chamada, which I understand them as a little ritual, like a little theater that represents in the microcosm what happens in the bigger horde of life, which is like a small little ritual inside the bigger ritual. Right? And the chamada is something that somebody is playing with somebody, then suddenly he stops in the middle of the horde. He can stop with his arms like this, or his arms like this, or even backwards. Anyway, he's in a certain posture that normally in a body language would seem that he's saying, I want to embrace you, I'm open towards you, I have no weapons in my hand. And the other person should come, oh, my good friend, and embrace him and all that. But what happens is that the other guy comes very cautiously. He approaches him. Finally, they give the hands. They go together forward and backwards. And then the guy who did the chamada, chamada means to call somebody. The guy who called the other, he says, now you go, and he does something like that, giving the impression that he wants the guy to go out in a beautiful cartwheel in a hoo or something very spectacular. But the other guy, no, he comes. So you start to think, what does that mean? And one of the readings that we can do of that theatralization, I don't know if you have this word in English, of that little game that they play inside the game is that, for example, the approaching, the beginning of something is very, very, very important. Be it in the chamada, be it when you start a love affair, when you start a new job, if we are going to share an apartment. Because in the beginning of things, you have to be very, you have to have a lot of attention, because there the seeds are going to be planted that are going to grow forward. Then comes the, when you are walking up, the love affair is going on, or your job, you have the new job, you have established already your position, and or we are sharing an apartment, is a thing that you have to pay attention to. In the chamada, in theory, the person is just walking, but suddenly you can break that by giving a blow. But it's not so delicate as the beginning. And in the end, when the guy says, oh, go, you have to be very careful too, because if you open yourself too much, the other guy can come with a head hit while you're doing a beautiful cartwheel, a beautiful au, and throw you out of the horde. Né? But you can read that in a certain way that gives you an insight to this malícia, to this malandragem thing that you were talking about before.
All right. I see a lot in capoeira jodas. A mestre will separate the women and have them play a joda amongst themselves. And I feel like that's something that inhibits the growth of women in capoeira. Why is it that mestres feel the need to separate women out?
Well, I suppose that depends very much on the way of being and thinking of each mestre, né? And I think there are several motives for that. I particularly don't do that in my academy, and if somebody does it, I think it's even okay if they do, for example, a thing for children, a thing for a certain rope, a thing for women, a thing for the young guys, for the older guys. I think it's okay. But the roda itself, I think all people should participate in it. Be it a small kid, be it an older person, be a good capoeirista, bad capoeirista. So I think, in my point of view, things should be divided more in certain moments in the ability of people, independent of sex.
I believe that sometimes you have the tendency to generalize and begin to make a judgment of some postures of the teachers in Brazil. We are sometimes forgetting the historical component, the social stratification that exists in some African Brazilian art forms. So the participation of women in capoeira is very recent. And I even believe that we had influenced in Brazil when in 1983 you took a large group of capoeiristas to Brazil, and half of those were women, in the case. And perhaps in Brazil, I think that 90% of the capoeiristas are men. The past used to be 100%.
I feel like the women are really trying to put their foot into the door in the capoeira aspect as far as the training and getting into the joda. I feel like in the United States, it's the only part that I can speak for, that there are some strong women that are coming out that are saying, I can run a joda, I can play berimbau and tell people, go in, come out. I can train and I can kick someone as hard as my fellow counterpart who is the same weight and size as me. And it doesn't matter that I have to wear a sports bra when I train, I can still do mea lucha con paso and negativa and shabbat.
The groups that I find more interesting, that have the best ambience, in which I find most interesting to be, is the groups that have a certain number of intelligent women, if possible good looking. This is not a joke. This is what I really think. And that this group of women have been there for some time, have some experience, and they have an active saying in the group. Because you know what happens? When you have such a group of women in the group, all these sort of schmucks, shitheads, they come in, they see those sort of women, they see, oh, these intelligent women, they're good looking, or they're expressive, they have personality, they don't feel at ease there. They go search something else.
Thank you.
remember that time. One of the first time I went to Rio de Janeiro to see the senzala in its beginning. It is after the Vem Camará. I remember going to the Laranjeiras on the top of the Rafael's house in which you guys were training right at the time. And one of the things that struck me, and I almost predicted the success of the group, because there was a very high level of commitment in the people doing capoeira. And I think that for the development of the capoeirista, this commitment is essential. When we are outside of Brazil, you have a large number of questions and doubts about how can I begin, how can I become a good capoeirista, what should we do about capoeirista, how can we become a good capoeirista, sure.
Yeah, well, that kind of relates to what I want to know about. A lot of times in capoeira, and I guess this relates to all athletic sports, maybe even life, but a lot of times in capoeira, we get to what I like to call plateaus, where like we're training, we're learning more, we feel like we're making progress, and then it seems like the game, you know, just hits a flat point, and you're not progressing. And it's like, oh, I'm doing the same movements over again, and I'm not getting better. And how do you feel about getting past that and working through that? What kind of things do you suggest to get past that?
Well, I don't know if this happens with every sort of learning. Maybe it is like that. But what I have observed in capoeira is like this. You go like this, and then you reach a plateau, pa, 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 pa. And it's as if in that time you were storing information or storing energy or whatever. And then suddenly you stay in that 6 months, sometimes 1 year, and in 2 weeks, 3 weeks, you give a little jump in the quality of your playing. And then you think this is going to continue, but doesn't. And for me, it has been like that. And many people have told me that for them it's like that as well.
The process of learning something demands a conscious effort somehow. Of course, there is all these things that happen naturally, but the persistence, the patience, the training, this is fundamental.
I'm interested in another aspect of training. I'm interested in how training has sort of become codified, or the roots of capoeira came out of maybe the time you spent outside of the classroom. And very recently, you sort of saw that window, both of you, where capoeira was really in the streets or on the beach more than it was in the classroom. And now there's, I think, a lot more classroom time, people actually training. I'm really curious what you see has come to capoeira through that training and what's been lost, or if anything. You
know? Yeah. No, I think it's very pertinent to your question. Bira and myself, we saw a time that the method that was used was Mestre Bimbas. They had the sequence that you did for, if I am right, for 10 or most 15 minutes, and then you had the capoeira game. In capoeira Angola, not even that. They had the roda, and you learned how to play capoeira, how young kids learn to drive a little bicycle. It was something organic, intuitive, With time came this method, this methodological thing, capoeira now in academies, in closed spaces. Of course, many things were lost there, and other things were gained. With the method of teaching, you learn faster. Today, for example, when I got the red rope of Senzala, which is the highest thing in 69, I didn't have a technical level that you guys here have with 2-3 years of capoeira. And it was the highest level of Senzala, which was already a top group in Rio and becoming a real significant group in Brazil. I find this this method very good. But, and in a certain sense, it has become too strict. So, what I'm trying to do now, me with my pupils, I try to do something in between. I give specific and technical knowledge to the blows, but to the moving, I let it free. I teach the ginga more or less, just the hand here. I don't load the ginga or up the ginga. No, I let each people do. I don't teach in the beginning the certain movings in the ginga, certain movings that you do. I'm not talking about blows or swipes. You know, when you go there, you turn around and you come back, or you go in a negative. I don't teach that. I tell them, I do some exercise that I call improvising exercises. And they have to move one around the other without thinking of capoeira and just trying to have a relationship of distance and communication. And only later on, after 6 months or even 1 year, when they are already more comfortably moving, I start to give them the clichés, the, you know, esquiva, change to negativa, do the rolê, or whatever. I don't say that this is better than the way that other people are teaching, but for me, is what I'm trying to do, is my particular approach. So I see myself, I came from Leopoldina, which he had a very free way of teaching, I went into Senzala in 1968 and stayed there maybe 24 years till 1992. And there was this more methodical method. And finally in 92, I went out and I tried to teach in a slightly different way. Like any person, Pira, and tries at a certain moment that you achieve a certain point where you look at your game, you look at yourself, you start or think that you are understanding things with your own head, you start to do your own thing. So that's my approach to teaching now.
Mestres out there who really stand out. Mm. You know, you have, you know, Mestres like Mestre Suasuna, who's a character in himself. You know, his game is wonderful. He's created, you know, Miu Jiu and his persona. Mestre Leopoldina. Mestre Leopoldina, who also had this great persona, and you would see them in the hodas. And without ever, maybe you saw them once and you really forgot what they looked like. But you never forget that game. That game was something unique to that person. You know, how, as a young capoeirista, can we go about really staying true to our mestre, upholding the way they have taught us to play the jogo, to play the game, but also really explore our character, you know, so that someday we can actually become what these other great mestres have become.
I don't know how I could answer that question. I think one thing. For example, people think, oh, the guy has this philosophical approach, he's metaphysical. Okay, I like that. But the thing is the game, is to play the game. If you could play the game 2 or 3 hours, maybe you didn't even to train so much. But that is not the reality. Now, the reality, you have a certain amount of hours a day because you work, you do this, you're married, you have a girlfriend, or whatever. You have other interests, whatever. So in our times, training is basic. You have to train. It's a body thing. You have to train and you have to play. I think that is basic. That is the basic thing. The rest, it comes in different ways to different people. That I think that, if I want to be honest, that's all that I can really say.
I have many ideas. First of all, the train is fundamental. It's the basis, the beans and rice of everyday. We need to dedicate ourselves because capoeira is a physical activity. However, there is a different approach to the train. What is that what in the cult of the personality of the teacher requires the students to reflect exactly the teacher's opinion? It is good, yes. The student will develop physically, they will be like a classical pianist performing a classical piece very well. The others is the understanding that the capoeira materializes when the capoeirista used this space to create its art. This would be a jazz musician improvising the capoeira. So, they are not things that are opposite. They are things that should complement. However, the reality of these schools is that different approach will carry capoeiristas to be classical musicians or jazz musicians. See our school, for example. All of us, we are different. I have my way of thinking about capoeira, characteristics, Mestre has his, Mestre has. And all of you three, I think that you have an important thing to say in some ways. So, and I believe that the synergy that we generate by being different helps the students also to go in a direction in which they will not reflect myself, Mestre Han, Mestre Lee. And thanks God for not being like that, because I would not like to have a Xerox copy of my playing, of the play anybody in the school. I want a guidelines that the student can go for. But to me, the most important is the desire of the individual to be a great capoeirista and let it go and understand that capoeira in itself is a very different discipline from any other, karate, yoga, whatever, physical education. Again, my sex, push-ups, sit-ups, stretchings in excess, as assuming, but this is just my own way, of assuming the role of the training of the capoeira characteristics, reactions, mood, approach to life, perspective, what Leopoldina gave to Mestre Nestor, what the life gave to Mestre Leopoldina, what the whole environment of Brazil at the time gave to capoeira. So you guys have the responsibility to look for your own definition. As you grow, you make the choice. I will be molded to be in a certain way, very efficient, beautiful to see, or I will be myself.
Ensinou a muita gente, de carroceira adotou. Mestre Bima foi guerreiro, quilombola de valor, camará.
Nossa baiana, ilê, raça africana, oxalá. Nossa africana, malê, raça baiana, sarabá. Nossa baiana, ilê, raça africana.
Descambava pelo mar, abaticando os atabacos, louvando o Iemanjá, camarade.
Nossa baiana, ilê, passa africana, oxalá. Nossa africana, malê, passa baiana, sarabá. Nossa baiana, ilê, passa africana, oxalá. Nossa africana, malê, passa baiana, sarabá.
It has been a great time to have you here, Nestor. Thank you very much for your participation. And I hope to see you soon here.
Thank you, Bira.
joga xeracol a noite inteira e não tem onde morar. Ele é franzino, barrigudo e banguelo, tem um rolo empapuçado e não sabe nem chorar. A gente vive se pegando lá nas rodas, preocupado em ser valente, só querendo se mostrar. A gente esquece que o inimigo está lá fora, insuflando a gente dentro pra poder nos dominar. Negócio de corpo é geração, está gerando confusão, sem nada a ajudar. Eu que não fico nessa fica de confete, muita bola pro confete, querendo nos controlar. Esse negócio de diploma é uma balela, para encher os bolsos dela e pra gente o que vai dar. O povo sofre, a miséria tá lá fora, nossa luta é